Defenders of Ukraine turned prisoners of war. Latest images released by the Russian military of Ukrainian forces surrendering after their defiant stand, some limping with wounds or exhaustion. As one of this conflict's most grueling battles at the Azovstal steelworks in Mariupol finally draws to a close. Nearly 1,000 Ukrainians have surrendered so far, Russia's defense ministry spokesman announces triumphantly, before detailing Russia's latest rocket attacks and what he says are US-supplied weapons on the battlefield. As ever, no hint of any problems or setbacks in what Russia still refuses to even call a war. Shocking then that Kremlin-controlled television would allow Russia's special military operation to be ripped apart on air by a respected military commentator and former Russian colonel who pulls no punches. Let's not take information tranquilizers, the retired colonel advises, and pretend Ukraine's armed forces are nearing a crisis of morale, because that's not even close to reality, he says. The pro-Kremlin anchor pushes back, saying there have been individual cases that show otherwise. But the colonel is insistent. With European military aid now coming into full effect, he says, 1 million Ukrainian soldiers could soon join the fight. While frankly, the situation for Russia, he says, will get worse. It is scathing. But he went on. We are geopolitically isolated. The whole world is against us, even if we don't want to admit it, he says, telling millions of Russians who get their news from this state channel what many of them, given the international sanctions on Russia, must already suspect. Recent days have seen the official veil of denial slipped too, like when the pro-Kremlin Chechen leader, whose forces have been fighting in Ukraine, tried to tell Russian students what's really going on there. We're fighting Ukrainian nationalists backed by NATO, and the West is arming them, he says. That's why our country is finding it so difficult there, he reveals. Though it's a good experience, he says. Not the experience, though, Vladimir Putin, who presided over a slightly muted annual Victory Day parade earlier this month, is likely to have expected when he sent his troops across the border. Russia hasn't lost its latest war, but expectations of a quick and easy win are being rowed back.
Well, Aaron, tonight that same retired colonel has again appeared on Russian state television, but this time there's a marked difference in his tone. Take a close listen.
When people talk about Ukraine acquiring the ability to counterattack, well, it's a big exaggeration. And as concerns the actions of our Supreme Command, there is every reason to believe that the implementation of these plans will, in the very near future, give Ukraine an unpleasant surprise.
Well, there you have it. After that controversial outburst the night before on state television, the retired colonel is tonight much more supportive of the Russian government and much more critical of Ukraine's military performance. Aaron.
Matthew Chance, thank you very much. And I want to go now to Ian Bremmer, president of Eurasia Group and author of the new book, The Power of Crisis, which I have one here. So, Ian, okay, let's talk about this, because earlier in the day, we were talking about the colonel, like, it's an incredible moment. I would encourage everybody to watch it in full.
State media.
And you have them keep pushing back. No. Russia's doing great. And he's like, no, you got to be realistic. And now it's as if he said the sky was blue, and now the sky is purple again.
And I told you before he came out the second time that I thought that this was enormously unusual. I was surprised he was still going to be on the air again. Because in Russia, you just don't come out like that. And of course, what we've just seen in the last hour is that literally he's a different human being His next appearance on Russian state television.
I mean, it is incredible to see it. What do you read into it, though, to the fact that he even said that at all, and then he comes back?
It was live.
Yeah.
It was live. He is a respected military analyst, a former colonel who had been saying before the war that it was a bad idea. And it was, again, live television. And I think that they just, the anchor was surprised. And they weren't ready to push back, and obviously they didn't have sufficient level of immediate censorship to shut them down. But they got to him, and you know, it's very clear that this is—it's not acceptable. People have gone to jail for less in the last 2 months in Russia.
It's just stunning in terms of what it says that somebody could, you know. I don't want to say lose is cool, or maybe it was very planned. Who knows? But there was an avenue for that to happen at that moment. You know, in your book, you talk about several crucial things that are shaping the world. And one of them, of course, is Russia and Putin. Yeah. So when you see this narrative out there that NATO's saying, oh, gosh, Ukraine's doing so well, they could even take Crimea. Obviously, on the ground, there are others who are saying absolutely nothing of the sort is occurring. Russia, in fact, has solidified some of that, even though the Ukrainians are doing well in other areas like Kharkiv. How close to a worst case scenario is this war right now for Putin?
It's close to about as badly as it could possibly go for Putin. This war has been going on since February 24th. And literally every week since then, things for Putin have deteriorated. The level of military support for Ukraine has increased every week, from defensive to offensive weapons, from more countries increasing. Remember, it wasn't going to be tanks. Now it's tanks.
Right.
The military, the intelligence support he's getting real time, on the disposition of Russian forces on the ground, from the U.S., from the U.K., from others, has been increasing every single week. And the level of sanctions, the punishment that has been served against Russia, the freezing of his assets, first time that's ever happened for a G20 economy, the fact that SWIFT, they're being removed from SWIFT, the bunch of oligarchs, the banking system, then it's coal, now it's oil, soon it's gas.
Is it yet the existential crisis, though, that puts him in the corner of horrific things?
Look, in fact, I would say it's quite the opposite. And I do say this in my book. I mean, the interesting thing is Putin didn't believe any of this was possible. He thought the West was in disarray. Biden was weak. Merkel was gone. Macron was going his own way. Trump had said NATO was obsolete. Macron said it was brain dead. So he's all in. He didn't think it was possible that the West could come back from that invasion.
So you see the optimism.
And actually what's happened is today, you know what happened, in addition to what we've just been talking about, Finland and Sweden formally apply to NATO. And the fact is the Ukrainians are doing better. NATO is stronger than it was before. And even in the United States, where everyone hates each other, the one thing we agree on is that first Pelosi and then McConnell both make the exact same trip to Kiev to show their support for Ukraine. It's the power of crisis.
And you talk about, you know, three threats. One of them, of course, is the pandemic as well. And I'm curious about the overlay between that and Russia and what we're seeing with Putin. Because, you know, he did this and all those things come into it. But it was also in the light of all these images we saw, you know, that big, long table and nobody could be around him and he wouldn't talk to his advisors in this complete and utter isolation, which is related to the COVID crisis. How much of an impact has COVID had on Putin?
It's clearly unhelpful that this is a man who has not been able to go around and talk to military troops in the field as they were training for what this invasion was going to be. Look, I think that there are lots of reasons why Putin, no matter what, COVID or not, clearly would have made the decision he made to invade, because he did see winter's here, there's all of this,
and
all these other things came together. But the one thing that he had absolutely no assessment of is he really didn't believe the Ukrainians were going to fight. And I think that if there had been better communication, he would have gotten more of that. Remember, he only had 190,000 troops on the border.
Oh, yeah.
I say only because that's fewer than the Ukrainian troops in the field. And no one would say you'd go in if you had 2 or 3 to 1, but not 0.8 to 1 in terms of troops.
No.
Remember, he calls it a special military operation, not a war. We say that's propaganda. Reality, Putin believed it wasn't a war because he believed the Ukrainians weren't going to fight.
Right, and he was going to be welcomed. Yes, there is. Right, and I think that's a really important thing to say as to why he's saying it's not just propaganda.
Yeah.
All right, well, I hope everyone will read this because you do talk about the threats, climate change also on the list. Ian, thank you so much, and I really appreciate it.